Good morning, welcome to the men's Bible class. I'd like to thank everybody who's involved in making this thing happen. The Lord first, though, hallelujah. Always the Lord first. Lewis, you want to lead us in prayer this morning?
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come here today, Lord, just recognizing that this is a day that you created. Everything in it, Lord, is perfect. The air that we're breathing and our hearts that are beating, Lord, are all granted by your power and by your will. And Lord, that sun that rises once again has done so because you granted it, Lord. And we thank you for your mercies, Lord. And we thank you for what you're going to do here this morning. And Lord, we thank you that you have a plan for Junction today. And we just ask that you move mightily and cause miracles to happen today. Cause people's lives to be changed. Souls to be saved, Lord. We just lift up these services here to you today, Lord. We know that your hand is at work here. We pray that you bless the speaker, Lord, and that you be blessed by the speaker and by the worship that takes place in this place today. We pray these things in Jesus' name.
Well, the Lord says be ready in season or out of season, and it's kind of out of season this week. You ever have one of those weeks where it seems like everything just kind of piled on to you? Well, we went through a season here lately, and it seems like there's been so much going on, so much battle with the enemy. But it's been like a little break, you know, with this fall weather. It's almost like the Lord's just kind of relieved of all this stuff that the enemy's doing. He's kind of put his hand there and said, back off for a little while, you know. But it doesn't mean that his work for us has stopped at all. Such a busy week, you know, I started the week out with a few little things on my mind that I wanted to do, and a sister came to me and talked to me and told me that a friend of mine has had a lot of stuff on his heart, a lot of stuff's going on, and that he was contemplating suicide. And I thought, oh man, you know, I'm friends with the guy and I love him, and I know the Lord doesn't want anybody to take their life. He wants everybody to come to repentance and come to him and have everlasting life. So she's telling me to pray for the fella and maybe go visit with him a little bit. And so I had this situation, you know, hit me right off the bat first thing this week. Another sweet woman that taught me in school. And I was a little turd in the class. Lord, forgive me for the stuff I did. But she was very sweet and she was good to me. And I got to thank Jesus for changing things. You know, the Lord will change who you've been when you come to him. And when I came to Jesus, he changed me. And this teacher apparently has seen it because she invited me to go and bless her home. And I thought about it all week, you know, I had all these things, like I said. And so I got busy again this week. But I wasn't fighting the same battles and wars that I have been, at least personally. But I was able to glorify the Lord in a few different little ways, and I really thank you for it, and I love you. And I hope that if your battles have ceased, that after you rest a little bit, that you stay busy helping the Lord get his will done here on earth. I'd like to introduce y'all to our speaker this morning. Her name is Patricia Witt. Thank y'all.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Would you mind please bow your head and pray with me? Father, we're here to praise you and honor you this morning. Pour your grace and mercy over us and unclog our ears that we may hear the word and the truth spoken into our lives. Bless us so we can bless others you send. May the word spoken today be yours. And I pray that all ears hearing it and all hearts and minds receiving it know it's your truth and it comes from you. May your will be done, Father. Thank you for hearing this prayer always. Christ Jesus, it's in your name we pray. Amen. Well, as you probably already know by now, God made me a woman. And I must confess, every time Joe McPhail because you see, my belief, shaped from biblical teaching, is that women are to teach women and children, women and children, and men are to sharpen men. The Bible is explicit to me about my role as a godly woman. I am to be a supporter to my husband and a teacher to women and children. I understand if, as a man, you're tone deaf when a woman is called to bring the word to you, and I come alongside you with that school of thought. And I'm here today because I'm convinced the Lord wants to use me as an empty vessel for him to say something that would really matter to someone listening. It's not up to me to know who that person is. My call is to be obedient to the Lord. I tell you all of this because I want you to understand I struggle because I want to be true to his calling. We all struggle, though, don't we? Recently, the Lord has been showing me an important principle that matters to him in our relationship together. The principle of we're not supposed to judge a book by its cover. Several weeks ago, I was summoned to be chosen as a member of a jury in a criminal trial in a neighboring county. The day started out as any other day in my life. When I arrived at the courthouse, I was processed with the other 200 or more potential jurors, given a receipt to hand back to the county clerk at the end of the day to receive my $10 for being obedient to my civil duty, told to go sit inside the courtroom and wait for the judge to speak. Knowing nothing about the proper etiquette inside the courtroom, I sat on the front row so I could see and hear everything going on with the judge, the attorneys, the district attorney, the defendants. You see, I'm a little hard of hearing. There were people sitting on the front row already when I got there, and they all appeared to me to be very solemn, very distracted, agitated in their spirit, and all of them were waiting for a bomb to drop, appeared to me. And in my heart, I knew there was something quite wrong with them, and I didn't allow what I felt inside to distract me from being myself. I allowed the Holy Spirit inside of me to minister to them. And at the end of all of our conversations, when the judge spoke for the first time, I witnessed the eyes of the girlfriend of one of the young men sitting there. She became alive. Her eyes became very bright, and she smiled at me. I knew she had accepted the unconditional love God was trying to give to her and everyone else sitting around me on that front row. And later on in the day, I finally got it. The front row is understood by all to be the place where the charged criminals, you know, those people who make the bad choices, the front row is where they're supposed to sit so they can talk with their attorneys before the court. I did not set in an improper place for people like me. I just knew the Lord sent me there and specifically sit among those being judged, to be in their midst. We can't comprehend his ways, for God's ways are not our ways, and his thoughts are not our thoughts. I'm thankful to him that I saw the hearts of those sitting with me on the front row of the courtroom, and that I wasn't blinded by their appearance or position in life. I'm reminded of one of my favorite verses in the Bible, 1 Samuel 16:7. For God sees not as man sees. Man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. We will never know the work God does in the lives of others he puts in our paths when we're innocent as children, his children. During one of the many breaks the judge permitted while plea bargaining was taking place, I scooted downstairs to look at the pictures and the maps hanging on the wall of the courthouse. And on my way back to the courtroom, I walked down a very narrow hall, and I thought I was totally alone. I was doing the thing that I do when I think I'm alone, feeling comfortable in my surroundings. I was just humming away with a bounce in my step, hop, skipping, and jumping, when all of a sudden I heard a man's voice behind me say, "Ma'am, you dropped this." And in that split second, I got really scared. I didn't expect anyone to be behind me. When I turned around, there was this young black man with a muscular build and a shaven head, and he was handing me my jury receipt. You know, that receipt is a juror you need to receive your $10 at the end of the day. Well, living and working in a large metropolitan area for most of my life, I would normally have been very afraid if I was was surprised at this man behind me. But the Holy Spirit took hold of me, and when I looked into this young man's eyes, the Lord revealed to me a little boy in a man's outfit. A little boy. A little boy who believed all the lies he'd been told all his life about how worthless he was and how he really believed the lie. I saw a little boy who was so angry because all his life no one loved him and everybody tossed him out like a piece of garbage and treated him with no regard. And my heart still breaks and breaks open for this little boy in a man's outfit. He didn't have to tell me. I had just lost a little piece of paper I needed at the end of the day. But he did anyway. And there was no light in his eyes. And he wouldn't look directly at me. Immediately, I thanked him and said how kind it was of him to help me that way. I didn't know why, but I sensed he intended to rush right past me. But because of what I said, he looked at me and said, "Where's the courtroom?" Nothing had been said, because my spirit told me he was one of those who were sitting on the front row of the courtroom. He was here to find his attorney and stand before the judge because of a bad choice he made. All the cases heard that day in the courtroom were criminal and not civil, and this little boy in the man's outfit looked like he'd been through this judicial process before. He had accepted his place in life and the label everyone placed on him when they looked at his appearance. Yes, he was a criminal. I instantly said, "Oh, I know where that is. I'm going to that room too, and I'll show you. Follow me." There was silence as we walked, and he didn't look at me. So the Holy Spirit urged me to thank him again for letting me know about my receipt falling out of the outside pocket of my purse. And I said something like this: "I just want to thank you again for your act of kindness. May God bless you today for being kind to me." And then that's when it happened. He smiled at me, a large toothless grin, and he looked at me, and his eyes lit up. It seemed he looked at me for a long time, and then he thanked me, and the blessed moment was gone as quickly as it came. And he walked on past me. Once I pointed out the room, he was gone. I prayed for him as he walked away, and he would get God. He would really get God, and that God's will would be done in his life. And somehow I believed his life would be different from now on. And for me, there was so many